time I was obsessed with an artist by the name of Nick Drake. He died in the 70s, 1975, at the age of 25. Suicide. And I was obsessed with his story and his music, and I pursued it for a while, and still have hopes to kind of tell his story one day.
There are mysterious people in world culture whose life and death have left us with more questions than answers.
I've heard there's a drug called morphine, but that's not where we're coming from.
And there are mysterious people who inspired them.
Because we're not really making it, it's just kind of making itself.
When we talk about the greatest albums in the history of music, we somehow associate them with commercial success, huge stadiums, and things like that. But there will be nothing about it in this story. None of Nick Drake's albums were sold out completely during his lifetime. And his third album flopped even more than his previous two. But at the same time, Nick became one of the most influential artists of his generation. He died at a very early age under mysterious circumstances, and even his death did not attract much attention to his albums, which for almost 30 years had been collecting dust somewhere on the distant shelves of music stores. We are essentially collecting information bit by bit. Recordings of his concerts have not reached our time, and he did not like to give interviews. However, all three of his works were included in the list of the 500 best albums of all time, according to the Rolling Stone, and had a huge influence on a variety of musicians around the world. Let's figure out why this happened. The end of the 40s, 20th century. The Second World War had only recently ended, and life was gradually getting better. A boy was born into a fairly wealthy English family. He was named Nicholas Rodney Drake. Soon after this, the family returned to their homeland from India, where Nick's parents had met. They settled in a place called Tunworth in Arden. This name is unlikely to mean anything to the general public. The nearest major city to this location is Coventry. During the war, it became notorious for being literally leveled by air bombs. Since then, the term "to Coventry" has even remained, meaning the destruction of the city through air raids. Meanwhile, Nick's mother sang, wrote songs, and played the piano, which Nick himself would soon learn to play. According to his mother, the classes were very difficult for Nick at first, but then, suddenly, everything began to work. And later, he admitted that he was grateful to her for this, and that music was his favorite thing. Many years later, Joe Boyd, the producer of Nick's first two albums, would say that if you listened to the records of Molly, that was the name of Nick's mother, you could immediately notice the influence that she had on his style.
Like a butterfly upon an April morning, very quickly taking fright.
As the years went by, Nick succeeded in studies, sports, and music, learned to play the guitar, and formed his first band. This was clearly not a story about a guy who rose from the very bottom. From the outside, it seemed like a happy time when Nick was simply enjoying life and the future seemed cloudless. And so it was. In 1967, when Nick turned 18, he and his friends went to travel around Europe and South Africa and even ended up in Marrakesh, where the Rolling Stones were at that moment. They even had lunch in a small restaurant and Nick played some of his songs for them. Relatives and friends do not remember Nick writing songs before his trip to Europe. But immediately after returning, he took a guitar and showed his family three songs that he had composed himself during the trip.
Pale sand stretching far from reach. It was then I found my princess of the sand.
Nick was generally a man of few words. Even his sister admitted that Nick remained a mystery to her. In the future, when the first album would be ready, he would simply throw it on Gabriella's bed and leave the room. She didn't even know that the musicians had finished recording. Nick went to college at Cambridge University, but soon lost interest in studying. At the same time, he met two key people in his life. The first is Robert Kirby, a young composer who would help Nick record strings for his first albums. And the second, Joe Boyd, a producer from the US, who by that time had already worked with Pink Floyd and collaborated with the major label Island Records. Ashley Hutchings, bassist for the band Fairport Convention, saw Nick performing at one of the local clubs. With each song, Ashley moved closer and closer to the stage. At first, he saw that Nick looked like a real star. He felt some special attraction. His unusual guitar playing, lyrics, melodies, everything sounded so unusual and beautiful that he wanted to listen to it over and over again. Nick ended up playing only 4 or 5 songs. Ashley walked up to the stage, took Nick's phone number, and immediately contacted Joe Boyd. Joe called Nick and invited him to the studio. Nick came with a guitar and a recorder. Nick had no vinyl records, so he brought the entire recorder with him. And from the first song, Joe felt that this was something special. During the same conversation, he offered Nick to sign a contract. Everything was going as well as possible. For context, London in the late 60s was the capital of the music world at that time. There you could see the Beatles, the Stones, Cream with Eric Clapton. The great Slim Jim Hendrix was already thundering out there. If there was a place on the planet where music history was forged, London was that place. In London, Nick continued to perform in small clubs and coffee shops. The musician was only 20 years old. This was a great start. Everything coincided, both place and time, and the right people seemed to appear by themselves. Soon, Nick began working on his debut album, titled 5 Leaves Left. By the time of its release, in a dark irony, Nick had only 5 years to live. The recording of the album took place in the London studio Sound Techniques, co-owned by John Wood, another important character in our story. Looking ahead, John Wood would remain with Nick when no one believed in him anymore and would help him record Pink Moon, the main album in the musician's career. In the meantime, John was working on Nick's first album as a sound engineer. The first studio session was a disaster. Nick strongly disliked the strings arrangements and insisted on changing the lineup. Studio recording in those distant years required a completely different level of skill for musicians. During those sessions, they often played with a full band and recorded in full takes. Back then, it was impossible to tune the vocals in post-production and quantize the guitars to the rhythm. In addition, studio time was quite expensive. Initially, a fairly large number of people were supposed to take part in the recording. It was planned to invite more than 12 string musicians alone. But in the end, they decided to abandon this, and Nick asked Robert Kirby, who was mentioned earlier, to help with the strings arrangements. This idea was received with distrust in the studio due to the fact that Robert was young and had virtually no studio experience. But upon hearing the final arrangements, everyone immediately realized that they had found the right person. With Robert, they started working on Way Too Blue, only strings and Nick's voice.
Don't you have a word to show what may be done? Have you never heard?
People in the studio looked at each other in surprise at how good it sounded. In Way Too Blue, strings were the only accompaniment. Strings played a very important role in the sound of this album. They gave this unique atmosphere to the central composition, Riverman.
Gotta see the Riverman. Gonna tell him all I can.
It was the first Nick song that I heard, so that was how I became acquainted with his works. In addition, Nick reminded me of another very cool folk musician named Jackson C. Frank.
Milk and honey, were their life.
During Riverman recording, Robert admitted that he was not yet ready for this work. And despite persuasion, he flatly refused to take responsibility. Robert said, "I know what Nick wants, and I can't do it." Arranger Harry Robinson took on this song. Work on the arrangement took 2 weeks. The song was recorded live with all the instruments. At the same time, disagreements about the overall sound began between Nick and the album's producer Joe Boyd. It was a classic story. While the musicians were trying to maintain their identity, the label was trying to make the sound more commercial. Both sides were right in their own way. Because, for example, as a result of such disagreements between Nirvana and Geffen Records, Nevermind appeared, the album that ideally combines sincere energy with the conditions of music history of that time. By the way, this same David Geffen, the future owner of Geffen Records, already at that time admired Nick's music and wanted to help him somehow, but Island Records refused. On the one hand, according to Nick Drake's standards, this was a fairly optimistic album that has been recorded in a good time. On the other hand, already on the first album, there are mysterious prophetic lines, the true meaning of which would be revealed much later. For example, the famous fragment of the song The Fruit Tree.
Famous but a fruit tree, so very unsound, it can never flourish till its stalk is in the ground.
It says that glory is like a fruit tree. It cannot blossom until its stalk falls into the ground. And in general, the title of the album, which coincides with the number of remaining years of life, sounds alarming. Although Nick was only 19 years old when he wrote this song. The problems started right before the album's release. The recording was quite chaotic due to the fact that the team used the gaps between other musicians' recordings. The final improvements to the album were delayed, and the album was eventually released in September 1969. Nick did not like the cover. There were inaccuracies in the song's lyrics that were being sold with the album. And in general, the advertising campaign was going rather poorly. Nick's first big performance took place at the Royal Festival Hall, before the performance of the exact band Airport Convention, whose bassist had introduced Nick to Joe Boyd. Nick came out, played a few of his songs, and left the stage without saying a few words to the audience. But everything went well. The people at the label were happy. They definitely saw the potential. Technically, there were two problems. Firstly, Nick's music was very intimate, quiet, and the larger the venue became, the less cozy atmosphere remained. Secondly, Nick began to experience psychological problems due to mixed reviews of his first record. Usually, this works both ways. The better the audience accepts you, the more relaxed you are, and the better you perform, and vice versa. If you are received coldly, you become constrained, and the quality of performance suffers as a result. It did not help that Nick's songs were written in different tunings, and he constantly had to tune his guitar during performances. Larger scale musicians can afford to carry as many guitars as they need without having to rearrange them during the concert. And here is a complete list of guitar tunings that Nick used. Nevertheless, it's hard for me to understand the audience's dissatisfaction. I love Nick's music the same way the Chili Peppers love Frusciante returnings, and the same way Frusciante loves the... Yeah. Needless to say, feedback from the audience has an incredibly strong influence on the artist. You clearly can feel the second between the end of the song and the applause. Sometimes it takes forever. During your performance, you convey energy to people, and they return it even more with their applause. And when I listen to musicians live, I try to clap the loudest, because I know how important it is for them. Although it is now common to say that Nick's first album was a failure, at that moment, it all just looked like a slower start for a promising artist. Nick performed every week, often opening for good bands like Genesis. The Holes looked something like this, and the recording of the next album had been planned for the near future. In addition, Elton John recorded several cover versions of Nick's songs. In such a context, all this clearly cannot be called a failure, except perhaps from a sales point of view. Nick dropped out of his studies at Cambridge and went on a short tour of local clubs, either spending the night with friends or staying with his sister, who, by the way, had become a fairly famous actress. Nick often performed. This was the same place where, for example, the Yardbirds performed. Jimmy Page played in Yardbirds before the Led Zeppelin. However, his music found almost no response from the listener, and this greatly demoralized him. In fact, from the moment of this short tour, Nick was no longer the same during live performances. His confidence quickly disappeared, and enthusiastic thoughts about the future were replaced by anxiety and disappointment. The first album was hardly being sold, and in order to speed up the pace, they decided to immediately begin work on the second album. Nick was left to live in London alone, and this city was reflected in his lyrics.
City freeze, get on your knees, pray for warmth and green paper. A city drought, you're down and out, I see your trousers don't taper.
John Cale of the Velvet Underground learned from Joe Boyd that Nick was recording a second album and expressed interest in participating. Joe called Nick. Cale said, "Tell him I'll be there in 15 minutes, called a taxi and immediately went to Nick's house. Cale greatly influenced the sound of the album. They worked a lot with Nick, recorded, changed something, recorded it again. In a sense, Nick followed Cale and learned from him as he went. It must be clarified that John Cale was a real giant in music. He seemed to be able to do everything. At the age of 7, he played the piano. At 12, he played the organ in a local church, then played strings in an orchestra, studied music at the University of London, traveled to the US, where he communicated with cool mold-breaking composers, and so on. And then he and Lou Reed formed the Velvet Underground, which influenced everything in the world. Subsequently, he would record a huge number of solo records, and as a producer and composer, he would take part in almost 50 recordings of other people's albums, from Brian Eno to Iggy Pop and the Stooges. Here is a list of all instruments Cale played in his career. In addition to Nick Drake and John Cale, musicians from Fairport Convention, Robert Kirby, and session musicians who worked with the Beach Boys took part in the recording. In other words, the lineup was going to be very professional. The producer was the same Joe Boyd. The sound engineer was the same John Wood. The key feature of Nick's sound was that the guitar had become the central element of the composition. And this is largely why his style has an incredible personality. It was decided to make the sound more pop-oriented, but this was a case of this is different. Here the work was done with taste and had nothing in common with the work of many modern pop producers when the artist completely loses his identity, both in music and in everything else. Good examples of the turn towards more mainstream music are Red Hot Chili Peppers and Metallica with their Black Album, when they managed to maintain a heavy and energetic sound, but at the same time added melody and choruses to it, which allowed the band to finally break into the mainstream. As for Nick's work, the title track of the album doesn't have a single word at all, and it says a lot. It is literally an instrumental track, so making a more public-oriented sound does not always mean to get poppy. Stylistically, the album turned out to be even more diverse than the previous one. For example, elements of jazz were added, but at the same time, Nick's personality has been preserved, which is noticeable in the bizarre harmonies, lyrics, and calm, slightly detached manner of performance. John Wood, who worked on a huge number of albums in his career, lately admitted that Bryter, Layter is the only album in his career where he was completely satisfied with the sound and would not change anything. The album was released on March 5th, 1971, became a commercial failure again, And although this album was the most successful in the context of Nick's entire career, it received rather mixed reviews. In addition to good reviews, there were, for example, such as Melody Maker described it as an awkward mixture of folk and cocktail jazz. Come on, Melody Maker, look at you now. Despite the fact that it was the era of solo artists such as Bob Dylan and James Taylor, who were known around the world and sold millions of copies, Nick Drake's album was sold very poorly, and Nick began to sink into depression and became increasingly distant from those around him. Nick began to disappear. His parents and friends tried to look for him, but he appeared on his own after a few months and then disappeared again. That is, all this happened in the same years. There was John Cale and Lou Reed playing in the Velvet Underground. There was Joe Boyd and John Wood working on the Pink Floyd single See Emily Play. And there was Nick Drake recording albums. Same time, same city. The history of world music literally happened around Nick, and he was an integral part of it. He just didn't understand it. At the same time, world music was undergoing enormous changes. With the advent of the 70s, everything changed dramatically. The anthem of the hippie era, Satisfaction, gave way to the gloomy gimme shelter of the 70s. Jimi Hendrix, Jim Morrison, and Janis Joplin died within a few months of each other. The Rolling Stones released their key album of that time, Let It Bleed. As one famous artist said, songs do not necessarily change reality. Most often, they stated. And nothing stated the reality of that period better than Mary Clayton's great part from Gimme Shelter. The tragedy in Altamont became significant. Let's dwell in a little more detail. It was a huge festival for 300,000 spectators. In the lineup, Jefferson Airplane, Grateful Dead, The Rolling Stones, and other huge figures of those years. It was something like Woodstock, but unlike Woodstock, it ended tragically. Several people died at the festival. Someone was hit by a car. An 18-year-old boy was beaten to death by Hell's Angels bikers. And one of the gang members even managed to knock out Jefferson Airplane's Marty Balin during a performance. In short, it didn't even remotely resemble a flower children's festival. It is believed that this tragedy was the final point in the hippie era. It went so badly that the Grateful Dead, the prime organizers and movers of the festival, didn't even get to play. The worst day in the history of rock and roll was December 6th, 1969, the day it went as bad as it was possible. The failure of the second album was a crushing blow for Nick. His producer and senior friend Joe Boyd sold his assets and left to the US to work to Warner Brothers. Nick began to experience severe depression. He finally shut down from the outside world and lost his bearings. The breakdown was noticeable even visually. Nick was shy during speeches, and during contacts with other people, he spoke a maximum of a few words. Then, he practically stopped leaving the house altogether. The climax of all this was a concert, where Nick simply stood up in the middle of a song and walked off stage. Nick consulted a psychiatrist, who prescribed him a course of antidepressants. According to Nick, he hated taking those pills and was incredibly embarrassed by them. In addition, Nick added marijuana in large doses, but this also did not greatly contribute to recovery. Island Records were disappointed in the musician and no longer expected anything from him. It would seem that our story had come to an end, but in the fall of 1971, Nick suddenly contacted sound engineer John Wood and convinced him to start working on the next record, which would change everything. Nick Drake suddenly came into the studio on an autumn night in 1971. This time, everything was serious. Just him and his guitar, for the last time. The album recording took only 2 nights, a total of about 4 hours. Instead of Joe Boyd, the album was produced by sound engineer John Wood, who had worked on Nick's previous albums. Nick was deeply depressed and only said a few words throughout the recording. This time, he intended to make his music sound the way he always wanted, not the way Joe Boyd, John Cale, or the label people wanted. This time, he wanted to speak on his own behalf. As a result, the album was recorded and mixed very quickly. The only thing Nick added to the guitar and voice was a small piano part on the song Pink Moon. Apart from that, it ended up to be a very minimalistic and fairly straightforward folk record. At first, Wood even thought that they were recording a demo, but it turned out to be the final version of the album. When the work was finished, Drake said something quietly and left the studio. There is a famous legend that Nick brought the album to the label's office, silently put it on the reception desk and left. And for about a week, the employees could not figure out what kind of recording it was and what to do with it. However, despite everything, Pink Moon was released in February 1972. The result was a stable commercial failure for Nick. This time, even fewer copies were sold. Nick suddenly agreed to give an interview, but in the process, he completely shut down and never even looked the journalist in the eyes. Internally, Nick was completely defeated. He understood that the last attempt had failed. He was running out of strength and money. As a result, he decided to return to his parents' house and left London. Nick was even thinking about finding another profession because he could no longer write songs. The thing was that the antidepressants that the musician was taking at that time blocked his creativity, but kept him afloat mentally. When Nick realized that he couldn't write because of the pills, he stopped taking them, and depression hit him with unprecedented force. Thus, the musician found himself in a vicious circle. You can't take pills because you can't write, but you can't not take them either, because then you can't live at all. He obviously loved music, and even in the darkest moments of his life, he listened to it a lot and played it himself. But the failures associated with his musical career only intensified his depression. Nick was very sensitive to failure. The fact is that one is impossible without the other. And for the ability to feel the music subtly, one has to pay with the inability to endure the hardships that almost every artist experiences to one degree or another. This situation can be looked at from two sides. On the one hand, you are young. You have just released your first albums. You are performing in good places. In general, something good is happening with your career. On the other hand, you may think that you are letting down a huge number of people. The label is suffering losses, and your music is not understood, and so on. Due to the fact that sales of Pink Moon were even worse than those of his two previous albums, Nick suffered a nervous breakdown and ended up in a mental asylum, where he spent some time under the supervision of doctors. Nick's only income by that time was £20 a week from the label. But at some point, Ireland stopped paying him that too. Drake wandered around from friend to friend who let him stay at their place for a while, but even there, he barely communicated with anyone and suddenly disappeared. Or he could take his parents' car and drive in a random direction until it would run out of gas. In early 1974, Nick contacted John Wood again and said he had material for a fourth album. As luck would have it, Joe Boyd, the producer of the first two albums, happened to be in England and kept them company. One day, Nick called him out of the blue, sounding very excited. They agreed on meeting, at which Nick was completely different. He clearly suffered from clinical depression. He did not cut his nails, stopped shaving and washing his hair, and looked very nervous and twitching. Nick was in a truly frightening state. His musical abilities deteriorated to the point that he was no longer able to sing and play at the same time. Even the style of singing changed. As a musician, Nick was so good at his peak that it was very difficult to believe he unlearned how to play and sing at the same time. Something really terrible must have happened to him inside. At the same time, they had a short conversation with John Martin, who advised Nick to just keep making music. But Nick no longer had the strength. He was completely internally exhausted and only complained about the injustice of the world. Nick was tormented by the main question: why did the musicians, whom he respected, praise his music, but the public did not need it? Joe Boyd, it was chilling. It was really scary. He was in such bad shape, he couldn't sing and play the guitar at the same time. We put down the guitars and overdubbed the voice. It was all one day. We started in the afternoon and finished about midnight, just for those four tracks. At the end of 1974, Nick made a short trip to France, where he continued to wander, and for some time even lived inside an abandoned ship. After returning home, the musician's condition worsened, and he maintained contact only with a few of his closest people. At night, he suffered from insomnia and locked himself in his room for a long time. And his parents tried not to disturb him. On one of these days, November 25th, 1974, it seemed to his parents that Nick was sleeping longer than usual. And at noon, they found him dead. According to the expert's conclusion, death was caused by an overdose of an antidepressant, which was considered suicide. Nick didn't leave any suicide note. I personally prefer to think Nick committed suicide, in the sense that I'd rather he died because he wanted to end it, than it to be the result of a tragic mistake. That would seem to me to be terrible. Nick Drake was buried in Tanworth in Arden, where he lived for many years. His torment was over, and so was his story. There are no obituaries or posthumous reissues. It's as if he simply disappeared into eternity. Island Records were not going to do anything with Nick's work because they did not see it as financially feasible. One can only guess what happened on that fateful night on November 25th, 1974. An analysis of his songs, and especially the lyrics, is worthy of a separate video. In his music, Nick acts more as a bystander than as the protagonist of the story. This fits well with how friends and acquaintances described him. He was somewhere nearby, but it was very difficult to truly recognize and understand him. It was as if you were talking through glass. His lyrics contained many metaphors and classic perception of the outside world through the seasons and their changes. If you listen to the albums in order, you immediately notice how the mood changes from a generally optimistic, albeit anxious at times, on the first album, to sadder thoughts and harmonies on the second album, and the completely depressive, almost undisguised disappointment of the last album, Pink Moon. And there the balance between light and darkness finally shifts. All that remains is darkness and its shades. Many of his friends and acquaintances found it difficult to listen to Pink Moon. Some of them said that this was exactly what madness sounded like. If we go a little further, at the end of his life, Nick recorded several more songs. In them, it seems that the author is finally communicating with us directly, completely without any complex structures. One of his latest songs, Black Eyed Dog, a slang word for depression in England, is worthy of a separate listen.
A black-eyed dog, he called at my door. Black-eyed dog, he called for...
There, Nick's voice sounds completely different, reflecting his difficult physical and moral state. It seems to me that while he was increasingly shutting down from the outside world in his personal life, through music, Nick was actually opening up to us more and more from album to album. You just need to listen carefully, and then you will notice how his approach has changed in his latest work, when only Nick has remained. There were no more producers and no more expectations from the label. There were no more imposed arrangements, no outside influence from other musicians. It is interesting that such a complex person as Nick Drake revealed himself most at the moment when he had only a couple of means of expression left, his voice and the guitar. But there is also a logical explanation for this. During the arrangement, the more loaded the mix is with different percussions, strings, saxophones, basses, and so on, the less attention the listener can devote to each of the instruments. That's how it works. But when it's just the voice and the guitar, you can no longer hide anything in the mix. Everything becomes visible. This is what creates the magic of the Pink Moon album.
Now I'm darker than the deepest sea. Just hang me down, give me a place to be.
But why didn't Nick Drake achieve fame worthy of his talents during his lifetime? I see three possible reasons. The first one is the label. Downer folk and loner folk are genres that are only becoming clearly defined in this century. Nobody knew what to do with Nick Drake then, especially his record label. Considering the peculiarities of the time and Nick's music, during the period of the late 60s and early 70s, no one simply knew how to completely promote such introverted music. The label received a record and had no idea what to do with it next. Only in the 21st century, due to the development of the music distribution, has it become easier for authors like Nick Drake to find an audience. It does not mean that in the 20th century he did not have a chance to gain popularity. There were chances, but they were simply much smaller. The second reason is lack of bright singles. Nick's music is beautiful, full of detail and depth. However, due to the complexity of composition structure and Nick's reluctance to follow pop templates, his works had no hits. It was quiet music, personal, which had no need to gather stadiums of listeners. According to the recollections of contemporaries, the public expected songs from Nick that they could sing along to. And the third one is Drake's character traits. He was an extraordinary person who attracted the attention of others, but it is difficult to call him a showman. Nick didn't like to perform, and in those days, in absence of social media, concerts and tours were important for growing popularity. The performer had to perform often and everywhere. The tours generated a large number of new listeners. Each concert had a potential to increase the fan audience. Which of these factors was decisive? It is unlikely that anyone will be able to answer this. I think everything came into play at once. After all these reasons are interconnected. Introspective music has been difficult to promote and obviously does not have the same hit potential as a conventional stadium anthem or a fun song that sticks in your head. Why is his music so introverted? Because Nick himself was like that. His music is like him. Perhaps if he had continued to give concerts, had simplified the structure of his songs, and had become more open to the world, then people would have known about him earlier. But would it have been Nick Drake? Nick's rather high starting position could have played a cruel joke on him. Not every person gets such a chance. They noticed him almost immediately, gave him a contract, a studio, and the opportunity to realize himself. It's obvious that Nick loved his music and thought he was doing something extraordinary. He was torn between the need to be heard and the literally physical impossibility of freely communicating with people. And the commercial failure of his albums only worsened his psychological problems. Each subsequent record made the situation worse. Perhaps this ultimately led to the seclusion, refusal to perform, and such a tragic outcome. The soul is a subtle matter, especially for such sensitive people. Essentially, it was a downward spiral, where a new album was a new turn down. It is especially sad that Drake would never know what his music means to people. Nick's career lasted essentially for 3 years. During this time, he released 3 albums and became disillusioned with music. It is a supersonic speed. There are many examples of musicians who, like J.J. Cale, only achieved something later in life. After a big punk rock concert in New York, English producer John Wood came backstage. There, he was introduced to Tom Verlaine, the star of the band Television. To Wood's surprise, Verlaine knew everything about him. "I have long admired your recordings, John Martin, Fairport Convention. But you know, the best of them all is Nick Drake." Over time, people began to become more and more interested in his work. Someone came to his parents' house, someone collected his records, someone planned their re-release. People came to the Sound Technique studio because they wanted to sound like Nick Drake, but the workers couldn't help them because it wasn't them, it was how Nick sounded. Here is an excellent musician, George Boomsma, playing one of the guitars that Nick played.
"When I was young, younger than before, I never saw the truth hanging from the door."
But it sounds different. Just compare it to one of Nick's recordings, which sounds really dark.
"Search of a lifetime to tell when it's home. Search of a story. It's never been known."
There's a good video on how Nick Drake sounded. Josh Turner breaks down the basic elements: his dead strings, hand position, nail length, etc. Nick was a very strong guitar player, and most of the complicated stuff was recorded with him playing and singing at the same time. Perhaps the studio was an ideal place for Nick, because there he could fully express himself without the pressure of the public. It happens that there are studio musicians, and there are examples like an early Red Hot Chili Peppers. People have blessed at concerts, but they don't really listen to the recordings themselves. Here and there, famous actors and musicians admitted the enormous influence Nick Drake's work had on them.
"In his short career, Nick Drake sold only a few thousand records and played a handful of concerts. Today, his music has fans around the world. I'm Brad Pitt, and I'm a huge admirer of this English singer-songwriter, who's influenced artists from R.E.M. and Radiohead to Norah Jones."
In the late 90s, biographies and radio broadcasts started being published. One of Nick's albums led the top of the best alternative albums, according to The Guardian. Nick's songs began to appear in various collections and performed by musicians, and then, finally, hit the charts. This is the sad irony of the story that happened to Nick Drake. An artist cannot live without self-confidence. Nick was a great guitar player, a great singer, he had interesting lyrics, he looked good, and he was a smart man. But all this was not enough without self-confidence alone, which in this case would open all doors. Just imagine for a second if Nick Drake, with all this endless strength, was also an open, cheerful person. I'm sure it would be simply impossible to stop him. The turning point was an advertisement for the Volkswagen automobile company in 2000, which featured the title song from Nick's latest album, Pink Moon. After it, more of the artist's records were sold in a month than 30 years before. Music, which no one cared about for ages, now has blossomed on its own. And now, 50 years later, I hold in my hands the great works of a man who was so sure of his failure that he could not live with it. This story is about how creativity always exists in context. So Nick's songs begin to sound completely different to the listener when he learns his sad story. Nick Drake has greatly influenced me in terms of music. This story teaches us how unpredictable the results of your work is, and that you should never give up. Who knows what would have happened if Nick's life had not been cut so short early. What we are left with is his wonderful music and the opportunity to pay tribute to a man who disappeared 50 years ago, but in some incredible way, his presence is felt more and more over the years. Thank you.